It is my pleasure this morning to introduce to you our first speaker. Our first speaker comes to bring greetings from Lincoln University, from the our foundation. His name is Mr. Willie Jude II. Willie Jude arrived at Lincoln University in August 2013. Jude, a Milwaukee, Wisconsin native, and 2002 alumnus of the University of Wisconsin in Oshkosh, received a Bachelor's of Science degree in Exercise and Fitness Management. When you see him, you'll know. With a minor in business, he went on to earn his master's degree in higher education from Washington State University in 2004. With over 12 years of experience in higher education, his career as a fundraising professional includes service at Washington State University and North Carolina Central University. As the special assistant to the president for fundraising and Lincoln University Foundation executive director, Jude has accountability for leading the university's fund development efforts, including major gifts, corporate and foundation giving, annual giving, and planned giving. Mr. Jude also has oversight responsibilities for the Department of University Marketing, Communication, and Public Affairs. Willie is the proud son of Willie and Patricia Jude and has three siblings, one niece, one nephew, and nine godchildren. Willie was recently married to his beautiful wife and love, Joey Jude, in June of 2014 in Atlanta, Georgia. The couple currently resides in Jeff City. Willie is honored and excited to serve his beloved institution of Lincoln University. Mr. Jude is really a wonderful friend of Extension. He is kind and generous, and you will enjoy meeting him. Please come to the podium.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Now this is the type of crowd that I like to see. Vibrant, lots of energy. I had to drink a lot of coffee this morning to wake up, so. So how's everybody doing this morning? Well, good. Well, this is an exciting time to be here. And first I'd like to say thank you to Dr. Matthews for inviting me to participate. It's always good to be invited anywhere, and I definitely am a strong believer in that. So I want to say thank you for your leadership, as she's served a lot of hats at our institution, but she's always there, works hard, gets stuff done in a timely fashion, and is an expert in her field. In fact, I think I've learned more about extension and agriculture in the last 2 years than I've ever known, and it's continuing to grow. So first I want to say thank you to Dr. Matthews. Now, I've seen a couple of our staff from Extension Services and Lincoln University. If you can all please stand, any of our staff members from Lincoln University, I see you out there in the crowd. I want to make sure I say thank you to you all. From all over the state, from Kansas City, from Blue Hills, to St. Louis, Jeff City, we're excited to have you here. And I want to say thank you for all of your work that you do in the field. And we appreciate it, so thank you. So I definitely will not be before you long. Want to say on behalf of Dr. Kevin D. Rome, Sr., our 19th president at Lincoln University of Jefferson City, Missouri, we say welcome. This is definitely an exciting time as we are embarking on the 18th annual conference, looking at a population that is vital to our institution, to our communities, and to the world. And so we want to say on behalf of Lincoln University that we are here, we support you, we are supportive, and we are excited about the work that is going on in these conferences on an annual basis, and not only what's going on here, but what you are taking out to the community. Before I have a couple fun comments, but I want to say something that Dr. Matthews mentioned earlier about the state funding from the issue. That's important, that is critical to the growth of our institution. And so here's a fun fact, well, two fun facts. We send $1 million back to the federal government every year. $1 million is sent back to the federal government every year because of this federally mandated program. It's not an option, it's a federal mandate. And so knowing that, we are having to start $6 million in the hole to make sure that we're able to support these programs. So imagine what our institution, what this conference, what this program, how all of our students, how faculty, staff, alumni, the community, how could that be affected with $7 million? That's just, you just keep that. So just when Dr. Matthews comes back, we'll have some more facts that we can share about how critical those needs are. So we definitely, as she said, have strategies in place to reach out to our legislatures and all of our local communities and understand all the great work that is going on at Lincoln University. One more thing, Dr. Matthews is gonna get me in trouble. I'm sitting next to a beautiful woman and she told me to reach over and touch her hand and all this. I'm telling my wife, Joy. So one of my neighbors is in here and Dr. Matthews said do it. So I just wanna make sure that I don't get in trouble. I have to cover myself. But as she stated, in my role with the institution, I'm looking at all type of fund development and literal support for Lincoln University so we can have these programs, so we can serve our populations properly. And so I'm definitely excited to be here, been here for 2 years. This is an awesome time because, can you believe it? Next year, Lincoln University will be celebrating 150 years. 150 years. So we definitely have a huge celebration that will be taking place the entire year. There's some people in this room that have been called on to serve on that committee, but we're excited. And I always tell them, we only get one chance to do this. We only get one chance to do it. And some of us won't be here to see it again, because I plan to be here because I've been reading more about the brain and how to stay active. And I said, I think I might have at least 152 years. It depends with all the science and everything. Because I was reading some fun facts about the brain. I'm an exercise science major from my undergrad experience. And so one thing about the human body is phenomenal. The human body is so fascinating. That's literally how I chose my major, because they say find something you love, but I wanted to make sure I found something that can keep my interest every single day. And so there's a couple fun facts that I wanted to share with you before I sit down about the brain. And Dr. Griffin, let me know if I'm wrong, because I may be a little off. My sources, you know, if it's on the internet, it's correct. Isn't that right? Okay, all right. And so, one, it says that 60% of the brain is composed of fat. Did you know that? So now I can tell my wife while I'm eating all those cookies and desserts, I'm feeding my brain. This is brain power. All right? And they said another thing that I noticed, that you have 70,000 thoughts a day. Around 70,000 thoughts a day. There's another one that says, the brain, technically, the brain itself, not the surrounding matter, feels no pain. That was pretty interesting. But one take-home point that I saw out of the 100 facts, 36 facts, when they talk about neurons and synapses and forming new memories, is that new activity creates new neurons, which creates more memory, which creates longevity. So did y'all hear what I said? Yes. New activity And so it's the key is to remain active and stay active. And in our brain, no one can take that from us. We may slow down a little bit, but our brain will always be able to remain sharp as long as we are open to those new activities. And so as I kept reading, it says, delete the nonsense and keep the positive memories. Keep the positive energy. Because with every memory, you're forming new neurons. So if you're gonna form new neurons, let's form it around the positive things. There's so much going on in the world. There's so much going on in our own individual lives. Let's choose to be happy. You work too hard, you've worked so hard, and you continue to grow it. There's no need to stop. Like I told my father retired twice. And I don't even know why he retired the second time. He's gonna go back to work, I know. But because that's keeping him going and that's keeping his brain moving. And that's what's important. Whatever you need to do, take away the nonsense. Like I tell my wife, I don't like to watch the reality show as much. And so sometimes as a bonding moment, I'm learning this compromise thing. I'm learning. I've been married for a year and I'm gonna write a book. So you guys can know. You may have some experience that you can share with me, but it's gonna be titled The First Year, and it'll be definitely a best hit. But one thing just to make sure, you spend time being happy. Spend time being around people who make you happy. Continue to learn new things and be open, because your brain can always grow. One stat said that you can get new memories and your brain grows up to your late 40s. And I said, if that was the case, then my 90-year-old grandmother wouldn't be online all the time and tweeting, Facebooking, and FaceTiming, you know what I mean? So you can always learn, and your mind is the greatest asset you have. It's the greatest thing on this planet. We can continue to grow it, and it feels no pain. So you're free to do anything and everything that your mind wants you to do. So again, thank you for participating with us. Thank you for supporting Lincoln University. We look forward to seeing you on campus. Come by anytime, Young Hall, any special events. We want to make sure we stay engaged. So thank you, and enjoy your 18th conference.
Thank him again for taking time out of his schedule and joining us. As we were planning this conference, I felt so, there have been other conferences where I've been very excited and smiling, like the one last year, Aging Artfully. You know, every day we were thinking of the new thing that we could do that was a flourish to Aging Artfully. But this year, the conference seems so serious to me. Because when you think about when Dr. Penn gave you the statistic yesterday, that after a certain age, one out of every two, and my dean told me that statistically, when you get above 50%, that really is everyone. But one out of every two people will have dementia and Alzheimer's after a certain age. That's so serious. And so whatever we can do to make that not happen or push it off for as soon as possible, we need to do that. So it felt like a big weight on me to make sure that we had a balance between knowing that this is really serious and yet having enough opportunities for you to have a good time, fun time. And so I hope that we've gotten the balance right, but if you leave here saying, all we did was talk about the brain, that's okay. Because that really is why you came, because I want us all to be able to, for as long as possible, be able to be fully functioning and have our memories and all of that. So, we have brought our keynote speaker, and as he makes his way to the podium, I will begin introducing him. He is Dr. Patrick Griffith from, and I hope I'm pronouncing this right, Sabah University School of Medicine in Sabah, Dutch Caribbean. Staying sharp with cognitive fitness factors for minorities, one key to aging well. Dr. Griffith was born in Guyana, South America, graduated from McGill University in Canada, and received his medical degree from Howard University in Washington, D.C. His residency was in neurology at Harvard-affiliated hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. Starting in the late 1970s, Dr. Griffith was employed in Atlanta, Georgia at Emory University. Then Morehouse School of Medicine. As a neurologist, where he served as chief of the Division of Neurology, then an adjunct professor of medicine, series 3. Department of Internal Medicine, he served as professor of neurology and director of the Medical and Clinical Research Center at Mehari Medical College in Nashville, Tennessee for 3 years. After retiring in 2013, he currently teaches in Sabah, Dutch Caribbean at the Sabah University School of Medicine. His research interests and practice focuses on the diagnosis, management, and treatment of vascular dementia, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and HIV-associated dementia. Without any further delay, let me ask that we hear this wonderful presentation by Dr. Griffith.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I wanted to begin by thanking the Creator that woke me up this morning. I also want to thank Dr. Matthews and the MEMA conference for inviting me and for the Dana Foundation for supporting my trip. This is my first visit to Colombia, and the Creator brought my wife and I safely, and we have been warmly welcomed, and for that I thank you. These are the disclosures, and I wanted you to know what's motivated me to do this kind of research. I was privileged to be on the podium with Dr. Sullivan and Ozzie Davis, and the picture that they chose is this remarkable mother. And if you can read the small print, it says, and this is quoting Langston Hughes, it must be because you're young that you cannot understand what it is to be old. So for 14 years, I've been trying to understand what that is. And I'll show you some of the work that we have been doing. So our objectives today are four. We're going to talk about not only the factors for cognitive fitness, which is endorsed by the Dana Foundation, and they have been very generous in that they have had me speak in many different places within the United States. The other is to look at what this means for minority seniors. And I was absolutely thrilled last night to witness the acknowledgement of our Hispanic brothers and sisters who came up from St. Louis, because if, in saying the word minority, you don't include Hispanics and African Americans, then you're missing the point. What you're going to hear as we go forward is that we're both susceptible to the same things. I'll repeat, we are both susceptible to the same things. So, how can you maintain the brain health as you age? And we suggest four ways. The four ways have to do with increasing three things. So you increase the physical activity, you increase the mental activity, you increase social engagement. And so the short version is exercise your body, exercise your mind or your brain. And the last is control vascular risk. We think that the problem for minorities is that we're operating in a situation where the vascular risk is causing the other things to not work properly. So, how would you lower vascular risk? Well, it's all of the medical things that unfortunately occur more prevalent among minority groups. So, the first way to go about it is to think about what can lower vascular risk. And you heard Dr. Penn last night and you heard the dietitian. So a big part of it is to be aware of what things you can do as well as what things you can eat, what things you can expose yourself to. When the executive director was talking about the environment, and you're correct on all of the facts about the brain, so your exercise physiology was absolutely on target. And I'll show you one area where my colleagues at Howard University have documented that exercising the body enlarges the memory part of the brain called the hippocampus. So you're right on target. Okay, so what things can we do? We can continue to go to school. Dr. Penn said that in Florida, if you're over 65, and I think it's the same thing in Georgia, you can get support to keep going in terms of college and education. And in Missouri, I would hope that you would turn to Lincoln University to continue your development. So, mental activity is the biggest part of what you can do. And there are a couple of myths that you need to ignore. The first is what the executive director was mentioning, and that is that the brain is constantly changing. They used to think that you had all that you were gonna get and you just keep losing it. It doesn't work that way. You can stimulate new neurons, which are the wires in the brain, by doing new activity. So, and my wife sometimes lets me borrow Oprah's magazine that comes to the house. And she talked about stimulating the brain parts that have to do with how you function as well as, so the memory part is down here. And it's kind of inside the temple, the place where you get headaches. That's also the place where the memory is occurring. You can have things that have to do with behavior in the front part of the brain, and then where there is a line suggesting that there is a different structure behind it makes you admire the job that the Creator has done. He's given us an awesome brain. An awesome brain. Okay, so don't ever think that you can not stimulate the brain by what you do. And so one of the geriatric psychiatrists from UCLA took license and he came up with this title. But when you read the book, what he talks about is doing things to, quote, exercise your brain. He's not a Christian, so you know, you have to forgive him for using the word Bible, but that's all it is, if you were to buy the book. The other thing about aging is that as you see yourself still having some worth, and so a lot of people say, well, if you were retired in 2013, how come you're teaching? Because I felt that I still had things to offer. And my wife said, that's good. It'll give her some alone time. So, when do you worry? Well, on this side, and I hope she's paying attention, it says if you make a bad decision once in a while, that's okay. If you miss a monthly payment, that's okay. If you forget which day it is, but you remember it later, that's okay. So all of the men in the room, remember to use this one if you forget something important like your wedding anniversary or your wife's birthday. And then sometimes forgetting which word you want to use. And the last is losing things from time to time. But on this side, if it's a poor judgment, if you are paying your bills twice, if you are losing things, if you forget, not that you know how to drive your car, but you forget that you have a car. You forget where you parked it, and when you get there, you forget how to make it work. I know this never happens to anyone in the audience, but, and then misplacing things. So the trick is to always put things in the same place, and then you just retrace your steps. Okay. So, what we want to emphasize is what things can you do that do not involve medication? And you see the fitness person talking about running and exercise. Well, I had to have a profile in Desert Storm, Desert Shield, so I walk. But you have to walk at a certain pace to help your heart rate, etc. And then you see the person's playing chess. Well, I can't play chess, but I can play checkers, I can play certain cards, I can go to Bible study, I can read my books every morning. And so there are things that you can do to stimulate your brain. So the two things that we're hoping to do today, in addition to the four learning objectives, is that what things can you do for the brain, and how can you age well, artfully, as they did last year. So the first, the second is the physical activity, which you heard about, and a couple of things to do. So in the checklist, exercise your body. So when you're out doing your 30 to 35 minutes, in my case, walking, just think of it as exercising your brain and enlarging your hippocampus, so that you'll be a better person in terms of your memory. Down here it talks about stay socially engaged with family and friends. Absolutely important in the minority community. And I know that the second keynote is a bishop, so I won't get into his area except to tell you that prayer is just as important as any of these other things that we're talking about. And then take steps to manage stress. So when Dr. Penn was talking about getting good night's sleep, working around people who are just as happy as you are, Dr. Jude talked about remembering the positive and not the negative. Stay focused. Stay focused on living a long time and living a happy life. Okay, so what are the benefits of exercise? If we just focus on the business here of not only that exercise helps you reduce stress, but that it improves your sleep and it improves your mood so that you're easier to live with. The problem that we all face is that we spread in middle age. And so what they found is that if you are active, if you do not sit at your desk all day, if you do not sit on the couch and watch cartoons all day, then your brain will be doing a much better job. So that's what, and this is last month's conference, an international conference on Alzheimer's disease. So it's that important. Do not sit around. And this is my colleagues from Howard and you see that they can show that after 6 months, it always, the question is, can minorities sustain an activity? The answer is absolutely yes. And so they were federally funded to do this study, and you see that in the brain, the hippocampus area is getting bigger as the person exercises. And I served on their external advisory board so that I know that all of this is accurate and correct. This is another study from the Midwest, and this young lady did statistical evaluation of the patients that she was following, and you see in yellow it says that if they were active, they performed better, their memory was better, and you can do other activities. So it doesn't have to be jogging, it doesn't have to be bicycling. And so when you're telling your neighbor, let's go do water aerobics, let's do Tai Chi, let's do meditation, all of that's good because you're exercising both your body and your brain, both. And this is a study where they found that minority groups had problems with their sleep habits. So they had trouble with falling asleep in the evening, they woke up early in the day, they tended to sleep in the daytime rather than at night. And you say, well, is that a minority problem or is that an aging problem? The answer is both. As you get older, the part of your brain that tells you it's daytime, so you're supposed to be up but not sedentary, and nighttime, it's time to go to sleep, it starts to not work properly. So there are certain people that are documented that if you have your main meal at lunchtime, and after lunchtime, you expose yourself to bright light, walking outside in the sunshine, etc., that helps to keep the part of the brain that regulates day and night functioning properly. There are people, particularly in the northern parts of the United States and Canada, that get depressed when it gets shorter days and in the wintertime. It's called seasonal affective disorder. The treatment for that is exposure to sunlight. So, a couple of tips for good sleep hygiene, and the one that I keep saying at our house is don't watch TV in bed, don't read a book in bed, that the bed is either for sleeping or for, but that's the third factor is that you keep socially engaged, and I wholeheartedly endorse what Dr. Matthews is saying, that we expect the people here to go back to their community and to stay engaged, whether it's as a volunteer, whether it's because you believe this study from Harvard that if you were socially engaged, you're less likely to have memory trouble, and that it may even prevent or delay. We're using the term dementia globally. Alzheimer's disease is only one of the dementing illnesses, and unfortunately, it's the most common. So, here's the problem. To a lot of individuals who are depressed, they can look and test as if they have Alzheimer's disease. And the way it goes is this way. If a person is depressed and they're asked a question, they say, I don't know. I don't know. So you have to score on zero. The person with real cognitive problems will answer, they'll guess, and they'll be wrong, and then they score zero. So that's been the clinical dilemma. They look and act like the same, and one of the geriatric psychiatrists from Nashville, Dr. Wells, used the term pseudo-dementia, or the current one is the dementia of depression. So we ought to be attentive to the fact that some people are sad for various reasons, and that makes them look as if their memory is not so good. So, what do we know about aging and depression? It can interfere with your mood, it can interfere with your sleep, and what our research showed, and I'll show you where we participated in a database that's housed at Boston University, is that in this setting, we think that people who get depressed, even if it's been a long time ago, tend to also be the people who later develop Alzheimer's disease. So this is one study, it's an old one, but what we found is that if we looked at our big database and we followed people complaining of symptoms of depression, sadness, trouble eating, trouble sleeping, etc., even if it was more than 25 years before they get the diagnosis of Alzheimer's, there seemed to be this connection. So we ought to pay attention to that. The other connection is between sugar diabetes and depression. So you need to know what your numbers are. You need to make sure you're being tested. You need to know if your doctor recommends that you need to be on medicine. And here's the exciting thing for me. Dr. Villamonte, who is at Brown University in Rhode Island, is a neuropathologist. And she, along with some others, are championing the concept that maybe, the tendency to get Alzheimer's disease suggests that there's something wrong with how insulin is taken care of inside the brain. And in her concept, the term is Alzheimer's is type 3 diabetes. You say, well, where does that come from? Well, type 1 is you're born with not enough peripheral insulin, the thing that regulates your blood sugar. Type 2 is what happens as we get older. So I'm looking at that because my mother was diabetic. My sister had gestational diabetes. She had problems with babies, etc. So it's exciting that maybe if we understood what's going on inside the brain with insulin, that we may be able to fix this. So one of the exciting new treatments, and it's still in clinical trials, is to give intranasal insulin, even if your blood sugar was normal. And it seems to get directly to the brain, and it may be delaying or pushing off this tendency to develop Alzheimer's disease. And you say, well, how does it do that? Well, one of the abnormal proteins in Alzheimer's is called amyloid. And there seems to be a relationship between how this enzyme works and amyloid. So there's hope. You ought to know your numbers for your cholesterol. The bad one is the LDL, the good one is the HDL. And the thing to remember is 200. It shouldn't be more than 200 as a total. So there are supplements that you can get, but more importantly, you can pay attention to your diet. So all of the things that the young lady said last night. This is to interject a little bit of humor. Dr. Matthews asked that we not be so serious all the time. And this individual says, if Alzheimer takes your appetite, remember to laugh. What happens is that as you get older, you forget certain things. You forget to eat, you forget how to walk, etc. So you need a healthy diet. And the thing that's gotten the statistical support is called the Mediterranean diet. And what's important in that is not the red wine, which catches your attention, but the fresh vegetables and the nuts. And this came out last month, where they're talking about 10 foods that can prevent dementia and Alzheimer's. And here's the list. I only took the top four, and my wife was reminding me, people asked about kale. Kale is in this group, and it's leafy vegetables, spinach, collard greens, but not with hog maws and chicken. and lots of beans and whole grains. So that your protein source ought to be from the food. One of my colleagues participated in a study in Kenya, and we're going to get into a minute about some of the African cohorts that have been studied.
And this gentleman is in his 90s, perfectly intact mentally. And they asked him, what does he do? You remember Dr. Penn's answer, yes, last night? She never eats red meat anymore. She eats chicken and fish. When they asked Pise, this gentleman from Kenya, what does he eat? He says he only eats protein as red meat twice a year. Twice a year. The rest of the time, he eats the vegetables from his garden that's never been processed, never been frozen, right? And then how does he get about? He walks. He doesn't have a bicycle, he doesn't have a car, he walks. Okay, he exercises. Okay, so this is a little bit of wisdom, you know, out of the mouths of babes. And so Dennis is telling his younger friend that life isn't a bowl of cherries, it's soap, vegetables, and vaccinations. Okay, don't smoke. If you haven't started, don't start. If you do, work on quitting. And so that's at the top of the checklist, right? No smoking and exercise, which we've talked about before. The vascular risk factors for minorities, hypertension, big problem. And this is from my colleagues at Emory in Atlanta. If you had, and it's a small study, but if you had African Americans who were hypertensive and they weren't controlled, then they didn't do well on tests and they had more trouble with their brain. So last night I learned something. I didn't know about Diamond, Missouri, but this is one of my heroes. And it gets back to that picture that I showed you of the lady 14 years ago. So Dr. Carver, and I appreciate being in his state, says, how far you go in life depends on being tender with the young, compassionate with the aging, sympathetic with the striving, and tolerant of both the weak and the strong. Because someday in life, you'll be one or all of these. So you have to decide which you are and act appropriately. So here's the problem. It's an international problem that there's too much dementia. In the United States, the problem is that as we go past 2010, it's going to go up by several factors. If you say, what is the part of the population that's growing the fastest? It's people not only older than age 65, but greater than age 85. And the statistic that Dr. Matthews quoted, in the study, people who were older than age 85, one in two are likely to have Alzheimer's disease if you get past age 85. So the two biggest risk factors for getting Alzheimer's, which is more feared than cancer or any of the other things, it's Alzheimer's, is age and positive family history. For Missouri, you can see here, and my geography is not optimal, but you see that they're in the bluish area, and so they're likely to increase about a third the number of people who have Alzheimer's. Here's one of the exciting things. It comes out of the group led by the neurologists at WashU in St. Louis. We can tell you by looking at spinal fluid, and I want you to look over here to the left, 30 years, I'll repeat, 30 years before you get Alzheimer's disease, we can tell you you're going to get it. Okay? All right. So, how does this affect us? Well, the problem is that both African Americans and Hispanics are more likely to get it than whites. And here are the numbers, twice as likely, five times, etc. And you see that at all ages, we're suffering the same problem. Here's the part of the background, that as African Americans, we tend to delay going to the doctor. With Hispanics, you see over here that they're often are not taking their family members to be tested, that they are having to take care of the elderly, but They're not getting them evaluated to see if this is part of the, if Alzheimer's is part of the problem. So, the third objective, and this will take a couple of minutes. This is a question that I've asked everywhere in the country that I've been privileged to speak. And I'll repeat the question. Are we part of Alzheimer's disease story? What do you think?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So, Alzheimer was a German neuropsychiatrist, and back then the psychiatrist took care of you alive or dead. So he, in 1905, gets a team together, and he's working for his boss, Dr. Kreplin, and they're at the Psychiatric Institute in Munich. And he gets a patient, Frau August Dieter. And this lady comes in, she's 51, very important. 51, maybe she's postmenopausal or perimenopausal. I want you to remember that. Frau Dieter was white, and you'll have to forgive me if I don't say Caucasian, and I don't say African-American, I don't say Spanish, I'll just say black and white, or people of color, that's acceptable. Okay, so the initial case is found by a white neuropsychiatrist in a white female. And this is her. And what she says is that I've lost myself. She comes into the institute and she tells Dr. Alzheimer that her husband is trying to kill her. Unfortunately, as a psychiatrist, he said, well, you know, what evidence do you have? She then starts to think that Dr. Alzheimer is part of the plot. So it's now the husband and Dr. Alzheimer against her. And so she's, you know, not allowed to go back home. And back then they didn't have HMOs and ACOs and all of the healthcare things. So she stays in the hospital for 4 years. And when she dies, he finds an unusual look at the brain. And for the first time, he sees a brain that's shrunken. What is not told, and that's why I asked the question and got your answer, is that history has not been kind to an African American. The first American scientist to work with Dr. Alzheimer's was black, and he was born in Liberia. He went to college in Livingston College in Salisbury, North Carolina. He came to the United States at 17 because his parents were missionaries. His interests in things to do with the brain are in the red, and that's why Dr. Alzheimer picked him to be on the team. So that's not told enough of. What's told is the fact that starting in the 1994, when our former president let the public know that he had Alzheimer's, you see some research that's gone on. It talks about when they first knew that this was amyloid, or when it was tau, so there are two abnormal proteins in Alzheimer's. But that's what they focus on, and unfortunately we lost them. But what I would say is that if there was a treatment, he would have been at the head of the line. Because I'm a veteran, and you never question the commander-in-chief while you wear the uniform, the question that you would ask without the uniform is, when did they know that he had Alzheimer's disease? Think about that. So a little bit of geography. The original studies that were done in Africa were done in Nigeria, particularly in a city called Ibadan. And this is loaned to me by one of the researchers from Indianapolis who would make the trip every year, and they've been doing this for 25 years. The same tests, community-dwelling individuals, and they watch to see who develops Alzheimer's disease. What they find is that the native Africans, specifically the Yorubas from Ibadan, get less Alzheimer's disease than African Americans living in Indianapolis. I'll say that again. Native Africans have less Alzheimer's disease. What does that tell us? Well, they thought that maybe if you're African American and you have a particular risk promoter gene called APOE, that you're going to get it sooner, and maybe that's why. Not true, that it's not just APOE. So the person that our group tends to turn to when they have questions is the minister. And so again, if the bishop is here, I defer. But a lot of people who are elderly question whether or not getting Alzheimer's disease is a punishment. I'll repeat that. I've lived a life, I've tried to be a good Christian, and yet when I get to be 80, my memory's gone, I'm combative with my family. Why is that happening? I don't have an answer. I just think that it's an illness. And I won't dare to quote the Bible, but it's not a punishment. So if you're going to get referred to a doctor by your minister, make sure that you know that it's going to take a while to get tested. Make sure that you know that the person has to be competent, has to be trained well. That sometimes early on you can find the problem where the person is even missing their appointments or dressing inappropriately, and as you go further to the right, the longer you have the illness, you get more and more problems. The average Alzheimer's patient, untreated, lives about 15 to 20 years. How long did August D live? The lady, the initial case? 4 to 5 years after. So we're doing a great job. People are living longer. But when you get past age 85, high prevalence. So how do you go about this? You try to find what can predict. So this lady, and this is known to me by another colleague out of Columbia, Dr. Bell, and this lady is desperately looking for her glasses, or sunshades, which are on top of her head. Okay? So often the person that's going to develop Alzheimer's has something called mild cognitive impairment, where they function perfectly okay, but their new memory, their recent memory, is not what it should be. And that correlation that I showed you, we can tell you 30 years before you get the illness. There seems to be a stage where the person is at risk here, and before they start to get into trouble, they get into this stage called mild cognitive impairment. And the question is, can you do things to treat in that era? So, what did we find when we studied African Americans? I was the PI in Atlanta. There was a group in Birmingham, Alabama, and in Charleston, South Carolina. And we found that the first degree relatives, if you're related to somebody, parent, first cousin, sibling, etc., you're more likely to get it. And what we're finding, and I'm close to finishing, is that it attacks our women. Now, I can tell you that one of the many places that I've spoken was at a church. And there was a lady in the background who was one of the church mothers. So she raised her hand and says, I know exactly why black women get Alzheimer's more than black men. It's because we have to live with. So being a first degree relative, being a woman, and they're trying to understand this business about APOE. We think that if you have two E4s, it's not so good. We think two E4s relate to LDL. We think that there's a problem with amyloid and Alzheimer's, etc. So this is our team, and I was just one of the people on the team. So now they're starting to seriously answer the question, why does it affect women? And this is from last month's conference in D.C. And unfortunately, it says 40 years she showered him with compliments. So Dr., when you write your first book on the first year, remember to keep a copy, because down the road, there may be a change. Fortunately, after 46 years, my wife has opted not to trade me for two 35-year-olds. But keep on hoping. So you watch about whether or not there's something scientifically different about the lady's brain. And believe me, I choose my words carefully. We think that it's related to estrogen. We think that estrogen in a young woman helps the brain to develop. Estrogen in a postmenopausal woman may be acting differently. Maybe. So that's one of the things that they're studying now, and they're trying to understand why it is that women's brain seems to be at risk for getting Alzheimer's. Now, they outlive us. If you ever go to a nursing home, it's more women than men. I'm just saying, brother, it's hard. It's hard. And I have to go home. So help me out. So this is how we find out if the person really has Alzheimer's in 2015. You have to do testing. You have to do imaging. And this has been the guiding light for my career going back to 95. So before I met the conference in Nashville in 2001. We have to work in a situation where currently we can't stop this illness, but we have to look at everything else that we can do to modify it, delay it, okay? And so I believe that we should treat it the best way we can. There's some things that happen with the behavior that gets to be a problem. Whether it's that you have a Maddie's call like we have in Georgia, if a senior wanders off at night. These three bottom ones can be upsetting to the family. And there's some new work that there's some medicines that are safer in that stage. It's a big problem at night. It gets back to what I was saying. The affected person sleeps in the daytime and is up at night. They're trying to get dressed to go to work. They don't recognize themselves in the mirror. They are not on a regimen where they're able to toilet on a regular basis and not get into trouble. So you tell them no smoking, no drinking, particularly things like coffee and other stimulants at night, because it'll make you get up. And this is borrowed from the new center at Vanderbilt. And basically what it says is that you should try to be nice, sort of like what Dr. Carver was saying. Agree with them, but misdirect them, distract them, help them to reminisce. They remember their first husband. They remember their first teacher. Nobody thought remembering your first husband was funny, okay? All right, so this is the premier researcher, Dr. Barnes, from Rush in Chicago. And she says there are four challenges for us as a minority group. We should make sure we're studying people who are unaffected. Make sure that the people in these ivory towers get out and work in the community in extension settings so that they're doing public education and they're looking at a wide range of risk factors, not just age, but diet, activity, environment, etc. And go beyond just the testing you can do in the office. So what can you do? You can start small. You can walk. You can eat at least one serving of vegetables, preferably green vegetables. You can go to health screenings. You can keep a log of what you're supposed to do. So it's all right if you have post-its and things like that. And star this one. Your family and your friends are only helping you if they support you. I'll repeat, they must support you. If you like singing in the choir, then they ought to let you sing and not worry about whether or not your voice is still there, because that makes the person feel that they can contribute. This was loaned to me by Dr. Johnson, and she thought that sometimes men who are accustomed to having their meals fixed for them, and you see she's got a doctor's bag, says, "I've been diagnosed with Alzheimer's, I don't know where your dinner is." So, what do? You allow Dr. Reverend Jackson to use this phrase, keep hope alive. We need money. Dr. Satcher, who I've been privileged to work with and travel with sometimes, talks about the need for investing in Alzheimer's research now, not next week, now. Dr. Satcher talks about his wife, second wife, who's having some problems, and he says he's blessed that he can afford the 24-hour care that she needs. But how many people, how many families in Missouri can say that? So in a lot of minorities, they have to not work so they can take care of the family member. Probably it's better to age at home, meaning that the government can subsidize home care rather than putting you in a nursing home and then you have to go visit, etc. They do better if you don't change their environment. If you have to put them in a nursing home, take some of the furniture with them. They may think that they're still at home. You have to endorse our president and his push for more research money. I wanted you to look at the people who are advising him. And the only one that I recognize, and I've been on panels with different members in this group, is this lady, Jennifer Manley, who's at Columbia. The only African-American female on this 10-member panel. This is the lady who has done research with her team at Columbia, and they serve diverse ethnic groups in New York. And she talks about how the education that a lot of us had in the one-room schools, etc., is a problem. And so celebrate the sister who's doing remarkable jobs and has the ear of the president. There's some research that's going on now that we can fix what's going on with the amyloid that's a problem. Yes, you have to start in non-human people, non-human entities, but to keep going. There's better understanding, and we have to exercise person here, how these wires work and how they connect to each other. We have a better understanding of what goes on with these proteins, the two were amyloid and tau. We need caregiver support, and there are national entities that help you do this. And this tells me I've talked too long. I appreciate my wife coming with me. It was a choice of my two teenage grandsons or me. And so I'm glad that she chose me. Do we have time for questions, or do you want me to stop? Couple of questions, okay. Do they need a microphone? Or? I can answer any questions, but remember I have to go home. This one. No? This one.
Research that's being done for Alzheimer's. Mm-hmm. I know KU approached me in regards
right.
to signing up for a study
right.
on Alzheimer's.
Yes.
So I was just wondering.
Yes.
And they were actually saying that they need more volunteers
Correct.
To help with the study.
Correct. Absolutely. So
The Alzheimer's Association locally has a table outside, and one of the brochures on there is about clinical trials. So I'll say this. Unless we participate in clinical trials, we will not know if the approved medications work in African Americans and Hispanics. The typical industry formula is you test people between ages 16 and 60 for about 6 months, a year if they have it. Okay? Most of those people, I would say 95% or more, are white. So when the drug comes to market, and I've been fortunate to work with some of the older medications, for instance, anybody remember Tacrin or Cognex? No? Okay, so one doctor in the back recognizes it. So I had the first compassionate license to use it before it was approved. We got better with anticholinergics. But when I went to the company and I said, how many people in your study were black? They said, either none or very few. So we then did a study in those three cities that I mentioned, Birmingham, Charleston, and Atlanta, to validate the fact that the approved medicine, the Neposil, helps African Americans and Hispanics. That's the only way to know. So KC is absolutely correct. Unless people like yourself are willing to be studied, that's the only way we'll know what will help us.
If you have a question, come up now to the microphone.
You had stated that estrogen loss has been found to be in women some form of cause of Alzheimer's. Could you share something that the audience could do to supplement the estrogen loss?
Okay. I tried to pick the words carefully when I said that even August D, and we don't know what her estrogen status was. The dilemma for physicians is knowing what to recommend for postmenopausal women where estrogen tends to decrease. So they did a study, it's called WEAMS, which is used only nurses, which are mostly women, and they gave them estrogen and they were postmenopausal. Unfortunately, they had more strokes, more heart disease, more Alzheimer's disease when they were given estrogen in the postmenopausal era. So all that's to say, we're still trying to understand when to give it, how much to give it, should we stop? I mean, it's not been answered satisfactorily. So I'm sorry that I don't have anything better than that, but that's why that study, remember I said that there's no new study trying to understand how it affects women's brains. So it's just one of the many challenges that we have.
We'll have these three, Ms. Ali, our St. Louis Regional King.
Okay. One of the reasons why blacks and do not participate in research, you know, we all afraid. So
sure.
You had to have
sure.
A place like Lincoln University,
sure.
Minority Health. My seniors, I run a senior center, and there's a lot of people we don't allow to come into the center
sure.
Because of that. So we're really gonna have to find some way to build a competence.
Sure.
You know, we have been tested
sure.
Out.
Sure.
So that's what I'm. Well, whatever tool we can find to help us trust you all,
right.
That's what we got to do.
Absolutely, and that's the key word, trust. And the only thing that I would say is, who's in charge?
Each of us.
We have the bishop here yet. God's in charge. Okay? We have to trust some of these people. Yes, Tuskegee was wrong. And all I can tell you is, we have to trust the current researchers, and they're obligated to come and tell us what they found. That's part of the problem. They do the testing, And then they go off and publish lots of papers, they get promoted, you get tenure as an academician, but they don't come back and tell you what they found. And so I understand your fear, but we have to trust them. We have to trust them. I know.
Thank you. I just wanted to mention, I went to a conference where they were talking about Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. and this woman presented this couple, mm-hmm. and he had Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. and they said for 9 years, he had been telling his wife, there's something wrong with me, mm-hmm. and she wouldn't accept it, and she kept saying, there's nothing wrong with you. Right. So then it's within us to know that there is something, if somebody tells you, I think there's something wrong with me, to accept it and take it to be tested or whatever.
Absolutely.
And I have a friend that one morning she got up and she didn't know who she was or where she was. But I guess that there would have been signs of her telling their family, but they didn't know what was wrong.
You're absolutely correct. And if you think of August D, she didn't come to Dr. Alzheimer until she was a behavioral problem. So he missed, or the husband missed, her saying that something was wrong, that her memory was wrong. So that's part of the problem, that we don't do enough education. The best person to tell the physician that something is wrong and something is different is the caregiver, the family member. And in all of the studies, whether it's Kansas City or otherwise, they say that the caregiver has to be someone who spends a minimum of 12 hours a week with that patient. That's first thing. The second is, when you ask an Alzheimer patient different questions, you need to have the caregiver validate that their answers are correct. Okay? So there's got to be a team effort. In Atlanta, we teach our students, if you have an Alzheimer patient, you have two patients. You have the Alzheimer patient and you have the caregiver. My wife is very supportive of my practice. She asked me to see the mother of the father of one of her co-workers. And as this gentleman was getting worse, and back then we didn't have drug trials, he came to the emergency room in Atlanta one day because he had a big stroke. They're getting ready to say, does he go back home or does he go to a nursing home? And the wife has a massive ulcer and has a massive GI bleed, and she has to be in the hospital because she's been taking care of him for many, many years, and the stress of caregiving. So we've got to do better to take care of both people. The caregiver sometimes needs respite. The caregiver needs support. The caregiver needs validation, whether it's from other family members or from their minister. They're doing the best they can.
Thank you, Dr. Goodman. Since I've been here, I've got some great information concerning the brain. That's really cool. And I've been reading some material, and this gentleman, one gentleman I'm reading, stated that the problem is we don't know who we are.
That's part of it.
Man is a triune being, spirit, soul, and body. We give a lot of attention to the other areas and don't go from the beginning. Once our minds renew to who we are spiritually, it makes a difference how it affects our brain. So the point that he makes all the time, the scripture said, let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. We begin to think like he does, it'll make a difference how we
do. I agree with you. That's why I said, who's in charge?
We cannot. We'll take this question, and then we'll have to ask you to consult with...
I can talk to anybody outside in the hallway. My flight doesn't leave till 2:30. I can talk to anybody in the hallway.
Would you please tell us what are some of the treatments for Alzheimer's?
Okay, so the only approved treatments are four drugs. Three of them are considered anticholinergics, and
So it's donepezil, rivastigmine, and galantamine. And I keep using the what's called the generic name because different companies make it, etc., or they may have a patent. So that's one group. And what they're doing is they're replacing the connector between the wires and the brain. It's called acetylcholine, that there isn't enough. And so the synapses don't work. The neurons don't talk to each other. The last group, so the fourth drug, is called memantine. And it works on a different mechanism than the anticholinergics. That's only the four. But there's things in clinical trials. And you have to participate in clinical trials. That's the only way to get beyond the four drugs that I mentioned. Those four drugs in combination probably get us 5 years, 10 years if we're lucky, and eventually the family has to say they have done all they can. This person needs 24-hour care. And then you have to decide where that care is going to be given. And you have to decide, and we're going through this with one of my wife's girlfriends and her mother, when do you stop the medicine? Because it's only giving you what's called symptomatic relief. It's not curing it. Back to my slide. It's irreversible, but it's not untreatable. The hope is that they come up with something that reverses it. And the only way to get something that reverses it is to participate in clinical trials. We did pretty good. We had a vaccine that was fixing amyloid, but they had some complications. The safety committee stopped the vaccine. So they said, let's go back to the lab and come up with something else. And they did it, but it didn't seem to be better than the sugar pill. So it just means we have to keep trying. We have to keep trying.
I guess my question is related to treatment. I never hear, is there benefits? Have you able to really detect benefits for people that are taking any of those experimental medicines?
Okay. So who do you think decides if there's a benefit? The family. If you ask the family member, did they value those 5 to 10 years where the person was more interactive with them? They say, yes, it was worth the money or worth the time. You have to get that kind of documentation, whether it's on neuropsychological testing, whether it's on neuroimaging, whether it's on changing the trajectory of some of those markers that I showed you that we can now follow even 30 years before the illness. We can look at those and see whether they're tests. The problem is that the pictures of the brain are very expensive, and so they're only available in clinical trials. No, it's just that it takes several years to, quote, break the code and see if it's working. We recently had a trial of a medicine called Ginkgo. Anybody remember that?
Ginkgo?
6 years, NIH funding of close to $250,000. What do you think they found after 6 years? No better than placebo. No better than the sugar pill. But you've got to keep looking. You must keep looking.
I can tell from the number of questions, the stirring in the room, that everyone enjoyed this presentation and has learned a lot. Thank you.